Matata! It means no worries.
Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase.
Hakuna Matata. Ain't no peasant craze.
It means no worries for the rest of your days.
It's our problem-free philosophy.
Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata?
Yeah, it's our motto.
What's the motto?
Nothing. What's the motto with you?
You know, kid, these two words will solve all your problems.
That's right. Take Pumbaa, for example. Why, when he was a young warthog.
When I was a young warthog.
Very nice.
Thanks.
He found his aroma like a certain appeal. He could clear the savannah after every meal.
I'm a sensitive soul, though I seem thick-skinned. And it hurt that my friends never stood downwind. And oh, the shame!
He was a shame!
What a change in my name!
Oh, what's your name?
And I got downhearted.
Pumbaa, not in front of the kids.
Oh, sorry.
Hey, everybody out there on the Tonight Show land. How's it going? It's probably going well,
hey,
I'm assuming.
Hey, happy Wednesday.
Happy Wednesday. We are so excited.
Hakuna Matata.
That was brilliant. Thank you to all the people who put in some hard labor in getting those in, and for Sheldon who edited it. That was wonderful. You guys are hilarious. Thanks for making us laugh twice.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, just exactly. Wendy, how are you?
I am fantastic. You know, I actually finished another class through Oklahoma
Whoa.
Wesleyan. I'm homeschooling just like everybody else.
Yeah, yeah.
So I finished my New Testament class this weekend.
That's awesome. Congratulations. You got a couple week break now, right?
Yeah, 4 weeks, and then I start class number 6, and my old brain needs a rest, so... I'm ready.
Nice.
I'm ready.
I think a lot of our brains are going to need a rest after all this remote learning and all of that. But Wendy, did you know?
What have you been up to?
Did you know that our show has kind of become a staple in the sense that people rely on this show to remember what day of the week it is? I've heard that recently.
Well, I'm glad that it's a staple and not a paperclip, because you can lose a paperclip.
And a staple just is permanently in you, and no matter if you want to get rid of it, it's there. So you're welcome. You're welcome. Hey, I want to just give a quick shout out real quick to Jeremy, who, again, DJ Jeremy, who made our new fun, another fun intro countdown thing. That was awesome.
Yeah, I actually saw Shauna shared a picture of him at the table working on this week's countdown. So he's hard at work doing that kind of stuff.
Oh my gosh, that's so fun. Well, we got a great show for everyone out there. We're really excited about it. Wendy, you've got, I'm looking forward to this new segment that you've been promising us.
Yes, my TikTok weekly. And I will not disappoint, I promise you. So,
all right.
Yeah, so this past week, I did make a TikTok, and I shared it with you, and let's see what everyone else has to say. Now, keep in mind, I'm still a beginner.
All right, let's see. Okay?
So let's watch this. Pew, pew, pew. Pew, pew, pew. Hold up. Wait a minute.
It's a chopper. Bop, 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 bop. It's a chopper. Wendy, that was incredible. You made me smile. You made me laugh. Thank you.
You know how many takes it took for me to make that, like, 15-second video?
I don't know, but I'll be honest. If I had a TikTok, I would be watching your channel. I don't know how many videos you got, but I'd be watching it.
Well, I got to tell you, do you want some more?
I mean, yeah. I don't think anybody on here would say no.
Let's see it. I got another one. Let's watch.
All right. No one can deny what I've seen with my own eyes, so I thank you for. Oh my goodness. Watching that video makes me thirsty for some high quality H2O. Wendy, well done. Proud of you.
Thank you very much.
Oh my goodness. Conquering the interwebs. This is amazing.
I'm not quite trending yet, but working on it.
Awesome. 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 Well, anything else we should know, Wendy, before we get into what we got to get into? I can't really, I don't know. This is like what, week 100 of this?
17, something like that. Yeah. You know, one of the things that we've been doing, I've been noticing like memories popping up on Instagram and Facebook and stuff like that. So I started sharing a couple memories on Instagram, and I thought, well, how fun would it be to do kind of a look back tonight at years previous in student ministry? So I had Sheldon comb through some old footage, digital footage, not like film reels, and piece together this video. So we have a couple minute highlight reel. So let's check this out.
A blast from the past. Let's go.
Yep.
Thank you. Wendy, that was really, really special. I noticed I was in some of those pictures, which makes me remember I need a haircut desperately. Yeah. And so I'm going to try to squeeze one of those out this week if Becca will find time to do so. And, you know, I think it's important. This show is kind of all around this concept of, like you mentioned, we were looking back, we're missing people. We've been experiencing loss, and we're going to be talking about this concept of grief tonight. And I know that there are some students who missed out on prom already, and there's these moments and these memories that are coming and going. And, you know, I think that was just really fun to be able to look back at what has been, but also to know that we've got a God who's right there alongside of us in the midst of this. And I'm willing to bet that whatever he's going to bring us to is going to be equally as good, if not better, than the things that we remembered in the past. So that was really special.
Yeah, I agree 100%. And I you know, my hope for myself even is that some of the changes that I've made in terms of like slowing down, that those would stick when we come back together, hopefully in a couple weeks. But as I was looking through these memories and just thinking about social media and how we're staying connected to our students, I would love for our students, our leaders, both past and present, to send us their favorite memories. Maybe you have pictures on your phone from NTS camp, or maybe you have pictures from Flower City, or videos even from a Wednesday night. Send them to us, because we'd love to share them either on our show or on Instagram, or, you know, any of our social media. So you can email me at wendy@crosswinds.church, and we would love to share your content. So you guys, send us your stuff, because we miss you.
Yeah, send us your stuff. We miss you. We do. We do. Awesome. Well, we do. As people have already experienced, Wendy, it's a little bit different of a show. We've kind of reordered some segments, and so take us to the next.
What? We're switching things up. So
yeah, we are.
Every other week we've had this segment where folks can submit anonymous questions to have some of life's tough questions answered. And so let's roll into our weekly or bi-weekly Ask Scott segment. Here we go.
Ask Scott.
Hey everyone, happy Wednesday, and welcome to this week's Ask Scott. So this week's question is a good one. What is the difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament, and why is the Old Testament still relevant? So when we look at the Bible, we know that it's made up of 66 books, and those are broken down into really two sections, the Old Testament and the New Testament. To really understand what the difference is, first thing we need to know is, what is the definition of a testament? So a testament is an agreement, or maybe a promise, a covenant, a contract made between two parties. So the Old Testament is going to be a contract made between God and the Israelites, the Jews. The New Testament is going to be a contract made between God and everyone else, Jews and Gentiles. So the contracts are different, okay? But they do relate to each other. So when we look at the Old Testament, what is the difference between them? Well, the Old Testament is going to give us the foundation of our relationship with God. It kind of gives us the rules or the laws that we have to abide by. It also establishes the basic principles of life, morality, things like that. And it shows us, those laws really just showed us that we aren't perfect, that we needed a Savior. In the Old Testament, there's a lot of prophecy in there as well on for a Messiah or a Savior. Now, the New Testament takes all that foundation and builds on it, helping us form a relationship with this new Messiah. It goes from the laws to how we can apply it to our lives. It puts truth to them, it fulfills them, and it gives us that Savior. Galatians 3:24-25, put it like this. Let me put it another way. The law was our guardian until Christ came. It protected us until we could be made right with God through our faith. And now that the way of faith has come, we no longer need the laws of the guardian. So in other words, yeah, that helped us get to here, but now we don't need it. But do we? Important to know that the new contract, or the New Testament, that we have. Much of it is based off of that Old Testament. So we really need to keep studying it because we want to, gives us a better foundation of who God is, how he wants us to relate with him, and how he wants to relate with us. If we look at Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount, that really gives us a great overview of how Jesus wants us to interact with each other and with God. In the end, all we have to remember with the Bible, love God, love others. See you guys next week.
No matter where you are in this world, anywhere, and I mean anywhere, there's always one thing we have to remember. I'm here to tell you.
He said, boing, 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 boing.
What's in the bag?
Oh, this is my always better together chicken and fries.
Play for it.
Who, me? You want to play me for my chicken and fries?
Yeah, first one to miss gets to watch the other person eat lunch. Backboard foul shot.
Between the cars, jumper.
Half court behind the back.
From the sidewalk, one bounce and in.
All right. Well, hey, everyone. Welcome back to The Tonight Show, episode 6. I hope you enjoyed those commercials. What makes my heart so warm is we've had new submissions of commercials. And don't forget, if you got a little extra time, we would really appreciate some creative commercials. And you can submit those directly to us. And they may or may not make their way onto the show. So that'd be pretty cool.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We do have some, like, review guidelines for the commercials. So
we do. Yeah, we do. But if that's you, we'll contact you directly. don't even worry about it. Yeah, in the comment section down there. Yeah.
So what time is it? What should we do now? What do you think?
Well, so we've been doing games and we've been discovering that we've been highly competitive, you and I, Wendy, and I think I have pitted you now twice in the game. You fared much better the second round, and you've only got me once. And so I think you said you were going to challenge me in a game tonight.
Yes. And so I traveled the country to try and find over the interweb. Over the interwebs.
Okay,
yes.
You legally traveled the country. Okay.
Yes, I traveled the country. And I looked for the perfect game, and I found one that I believe your logic will have absolutely no bearing in.
No. It's the only thing I have going for me.
I know. So this ought to be good. The name of the game is Which Town is Real? So I am going to show you three town names within a state, and you have to pick of the three, which is the real town name. So we have 10 questions plus one bonus.
All right.
So I want the audience to play along, keep track of your scores, and let's see who can beat Brian at Which Town is Real. Are you ready?
I'm ready. So just to make sure, I'm going to be shown a town that's fake or real, and I have to choose which one's the real one.
No, you're going to be shown a list of three town names.
Yes.
Okay. Three town names, and of those three town names, you have to pick the real one.
Okay.
One of the three. It's multiple choice. You have like a 33.3% chance of getting each question right.
3-3-3-3 repeating. Yes. Okay. So this is going to be tough because 50-50 flip a coin is not on my side.
See, this is why I went with this
All right.
game.
Let's do it.
Not that I'm competitive, but all right. Question one. Are you ready?
I'm ready, and I'm going to take down the audience again. Here we go.
All right. So we're looking at the state of Arizona in question one. You have Old Nine Center, 56 Tank, and Numbers. Which of those is a real town in Arizona? Pick the real one.
So I don't know much about Arizona, except that Chris Taylor and Aaron Collard, two of my coworkers, are from there. And they seem kind of redneckish, if you will. So I'm just joking. I'm gonna say.
And they're probably watching.
I'm gonna say 56 Tank.
56 Tank. Final answer.
Final answer.
All right. What? You got that one right,
Brian. Are you serious?
Oh my goodness. That one right.
Wow!
Well done.
All right, and the game is over. 1-1.
No, it's not. We're going to keep playing. All right.
All right.
Question two. We're heading to the great state of Arkansas. Your town names are Toad Suck, Squirrel Springs, and Hairy Bear.
Which one
is the real town?
I don't want to, you know, paint any judgment here, but I could see all of these things being true of the great state of Arkansas.
And it is great indeed. All right, let's hear your logic on how you're going to...
I have no logic here, except I'm looking at these Toad Suck, Squirrel Springs, Hairy Bear. The funniest, this is my logic now. What's the funniest? I think Hairy Bear is the funniest. That would be amazing if I lived in the town of Hairy Bear. So, Hairy Bear, final answer.
Hairy Bear, final answer. No, the answer is Toad Suck. Toad Suck, Arkansas. Don't you want to visit there?
I don't. Are you keeping score?
I am.
Okay, so I'm 1-2. This is not good. Question three. All right, here we go.
Question three, we're going to Alaska, okay?
Oh,
so
yes.
You know that, right? You've been there all the time. So,
yeah,
Turkey
I drive there all the
Scrub,
time.
Raptor Ridge, or Chicken, Alaska?
All right, here's my logic. Alaska is freezing cold. Therefore, two of these creatures, turkey and chicken, are birds. And I don't think they live in Alaska like we think they do. Okay. I think there was a raptor that was discovered there, fossilized. I say Raptor Ridge is the final answer there.
You're trying to use logic. Raptor
Let's
Ridge,
go.
Final answer.
Final
and
answer.
You are incorrect. It is chicken.
There's a town
chicken,
called Chicken?
Alaska.
Oh my goodness.
There is.
What do they do?
Chicken,
like,
Alaska.
Stumble into that town and see a chicken and be like, oh, this is Chicken, Alaska. I don't know.
Yeah. I guess so. I've never been there, but I don't know. All right. You're doing great. You are doing great. Okay,
don't
here
you
we
lie
go.
To me.
Question four, we're going to Kentucky. Okay.
All right. Oh, yeah.
We have Rabbit Hash, Greasy Gopher, and Roadkill, Kentucky.
The poor people that would live in Roadkill, Kentucky. I mean, they just can't feel good about themselves. So I'm not going to say roadkill. Rabbit hash is like a weird Kentucky food. That's kind of what it sounds like. I'm going to say greasy gopher because, again, that's the funniest. And that's my logic right now. Greasy gopher, final answer.
Greasy gopher, final answer. And you are incorrect.
No!
The answer is rabbit hash, Kentucky.
Oh, my goodness. So far,
I picked a good one. You have 1 out of 4 correct.
All right, 25%.
Ready for number 5?
Yeah, I'm backed into a corner. This is
yourself.
This is where I start excelling under pressure.
Okay, right. So number 5, we're going to New Mexico.
Oh,
all right, so you have Password, Truth or Consequences, and Game Show.
These are all like game show theme type. I don't know. I have no idea. So I'm going to then resort to. What I used to do, I did this on the SATs, no joke, is I would create a box and I would drop my pencil, A, B, C, or D, and whatever one it would hit, that's the one I would choose. It's probably why I scored so low. I am going to choose Game Show New Mexico.
Game Show New Mexico, final answer on this game.
Final answer.
Oh, Brian, I am so sorry. The answer is Truth or Consequences, New Mexico.
Who would name their town that? If you
Apparently
live in that town, and if you're listening, petition, please. Oh, my goodness.
I know. All right. So you're 1 out of 5 so far.
Okay.
We're now going to Missouri, okay?
Okay. Another
Missouri.
State that I know a lot about.
Okay, good. So Frankenstein, Dracula Flats, or Godzilla Burg?
I just... Godzilla Burg, like... if that is true, I am packing up my house and I'm moving there tomorrow, if legal. I'm going to say Frankenstein, Missouri. Frankenstein, Missouri, final answer.
Final answer?
Final answer.
Oh, Brian, you got one right. So now
yes!
You are 2 out of 6. All
That's
right.
That's what I'm talking about.
All right.
I'm back
You're
up to 33%.
Back up now.
Yes, yes, yes.
Right.
Here I come.
We're going to Mississippi. You ready?
Okay. No, I can spell that though.
All right. Well, I believe you, but we're going to go with Cold Beans, Mississippi, Bananaville, Mississippi, or Hot Coffee, Mississippi.
Can I just make one observation?
Sure.
All of these are southern states. That's my observation. Okay? We haven't seen a crazy, ridiculous north state yet.
New
All right,
York.
So cold beans, Bananaville, or hot coffee, Missouri. I mean, Bananaville, again, that's just hilarious. Cold beans, Missouri would be a dream come true to live there if that was a true town name. So, no? Yes. Cold beans, final answer. Lock it in.
Cold beans, final answer.
Yep.
You know, it looked like you were going to change there, and maybe you should have, because the answer was hot coffee, Mississippi. That is a place that I would love to live, is hot coffee.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. I am bringing shame to my family.
We're changing things up. We're going up north to Wisconsin.
Oh, okay. The cheeseheads.
Little Midwest. All right, here we go. Right. So, tree frog slough, Wisconsin. Spread eagle or kitty corners, Wisconsin.
Kitty corners. Spread eagle. Okay. Tree frog slough. If I could phone a friend, I would phone.
Who would you phone? You can't. So, you're going to have to.
I would phone, I think Craig Cooper lived there. I'm almost positive.
Oh.
But maybe not.
Which means maybe Will did too.
I'm going to say Kitty, no. Spread eagles. Spread eagle. Final answer.
You're going spread eagle, final answer. All right, Brian, you got another one right. You are 3 for 8, 3 out of 8.
All right.
Well done, well done.
Thank you.
All right,
Thank
number
you.
Nine. Number nine. You could like tie this up here. Okay. So, Ohio. We're going to Ohio.
All right. I'm getting close to
New
York here.
We have Pocum, Ohio. We have Whipping Stone, Ohio, and Knock 'em Stiff, Ohio.
Oh, man. Okay. I think Knock 'em Stiff would just be so awesome. And I would love to know who lives there, if this is a true town. I'm going to say Knock 'em Stiff, final answer.
That's Knock 'em Stiff, final answer. Whatever you're doing these last couple, it's working for you. That is
Whoa.
The correct answer.
All right.
You now have 4 out of 9 correct.
Oh, man. All right. Here I come. I told you, here I come.
So, number 10. This is number 10, and we're going to the great big state of Texas. All right?
Okay.
So, we have Point and Click, Texas. We have Cut and Shoot, Texas. And we have Pick and Roll, Texas.
There's stereotypes about Texas, and these names are confirming some of those stereotypes. Okay, so, Point and Click is just terrible. Cut and Shoot is also terrible. Pick and Roll is not as terrible, so I'm gonna go with one of the terribles. I'm gonna say Point and Click.
Point and Click.
Point and Click, Texas. I live in Point and Click, Texas. Come on down.
Final answer.
Okay. Final answer.
I am so sorry, but the answer is Cut and Shoot. Cut and Shoot, Texas.
Oh, man.
Cut and Shoot, Texas.
Cut and Shoot, Texas. All right.
All right. Well, you can't. So you've got, what do you got? 4 out of 10 right now. You could finish with 5 out of 11. That's going to be
so
the best you can
total.
Do if you can get this bonus question right. We are going back to Arizona for this bonus question. Are you ready?
Okay. No.
You did so well the first time.
I don't think I did.
All right. No, you didn't. But here
right.
we go. You can redeem yourself. Happy
All
Jack,
right.
Arizona, Smiling yep. Mill, or Merry Mirth, Arizona.
Happy Jack, Smiling Mill, Merry Mirth. Merry Mirth, Arizona. Again, I default to Chris. I just think of Chris. You know, what is Chris all about? And that guy, he's a Happy Jack. Happy Jack, Arizona. Final answer.
You're going Happy Jack, Arizona. Final answer.
Final
and
answer.
You are correct.
Whoa,
you are
come
correct.
On. Chris,
so,
thank you.
Brian, well done. You
thank
finished. You got 5 out of 11 correct. I'll be interested to see how the audience has done as they've played along with you. And I'm feeling much better about myself.
Because I'm a loser?
It's kind of like I feel like redeemed from the whole YouTube debacle a couple weeks ago. So,
well, hey, thank you so much for picking a game that had nothing to do with logic. But for all those geography buffs out there, I'll be interested to see how they did in the comments. Yeah.
And I want to know if anyone's ever visited any of those places.
Yeah. Yeah, that'd be good, too. That'd be good, too. Hey,
yeah.
Wendy, go long. Oh, Nice, nice. Well, hey, we are going to a commercial break. And when we come back, again, the show, you may have feel like, hey, this isn't in order. There's some pieces missing. Again, there's some different elements. And when we come back, we're going to be listening in on even a different element. So I'm excited about that. And so stay tuned. And I'm really just looking forward to what we got in store. It's going to be a good rest of the show. Thank you.
Out of some boxes, come on down to Lily's Box Emporium. We have boxes in all shapes and sizes, and unlike most stores, we have an unlimited supply. Act now and get your boxes 100% off.
I'll take a box.
Keep your money. Take a box.
Boxes, boxes, get your boxes today.
Well, hey guys, welcome back to the Tonight Show. So as you noticed, things probably look a little bit different tonight in terms of the order and the content and what we're doing. Brian and I kind of wanted to mix it up a little bit and give you guys something different. And so we're doing the same thing with the interview segment. You know, each week we try to bring a special guest on and just spend a few minutes with them, asking them some personal questions so that you can either get to know them or maybe learn something new. This week, we took a little bit of a different approach. So you notice we didn't do a top 10 at the beginning. Well, after Brian's teaching here a couple weeks ago, we looked at 2 Timothy 3:16 and talked about how all scripture is God-breathed, right? And how God uses it to correct, to teach, to rebuke, all of those things. And it just got me thinking that I wanted to hear from some of you guys. So instead of doing a top 10 and instead of doing like a traditional interview video, what I did was I reached out to 10 different students and I said, hey, what is your favorite verse? What is your favorite scripture? And if you feel comfortable, share the scripture and let us know why it's meaningful to you. And so I have 10 of your peers who are going to share their favorite scripture. So here we go.
My favorite Bible verse is Psalms 18:30 because it says how perfect God is and how flawless his word is, and anyone who finds refuge in him, he will shield, which means he will protect them.
One of my favorite verses is 1 Corinthians 13:6-7. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. I love this verse because throughout the Bible, Jesus always says that he's love. And if Jesus is love, then that also means that he's all of these traits, which makes him the perfect example for us. So whenever I'm tempted, I can find encouragement in this verse to act lovingly rather than sinfully.
I would say that my favorite Bible verse is Proverbs 27:1. It is, don't brag about tomorrow since you don't know what tomorrow will bring. I really like that Bible verse because it's a great reminder that I should always live according to God's plan and not living according to mine. I should put full trust and faith into what he wants me to do, no matter what it is, because his plan is the right plan. Thank you.
Hebrews 12:1-2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God.
Philippians 4:6-7 says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understandings, can guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus our Lord." So if you're anxious about anything, I really just think that is a great verse. So just remember that and keep it in your mind.
My favorite verse actually goes with another verse in Psalm 91. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him I will trust. That's my favorite verse because it reminds me to always, always trust. Trust not because I have to trust, because he is God, he is the Almighty.
Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. This verse was the first verse I truly memorized. And so it just means to me that no matter how far I stray from the path of God, he's always going to be with me, crucified within me.
My favorite verse in the Bible is the first verse that was written in the Bible, so Genesis 1. I just think it's the best verse because it talks about what we should worship and who we should worship, because he created everything and God created everything and started all life as it is.
So one of my favorite Bible verses is 1 Thessalonians 5:5, which says, "For you are all children of the light and day. We don't belong to darkness and the night." This one's one of my favorites because it reminds me that even though I might go through rough patches and hard times in my life, I don't belong to that darkness because I'm a child of God.
So my favorite Bible verse is Psalm 94:19. It says this, "When anxiety was brought within me, your consolation brought me joy." That Bible verse can actually help you guys through this pandemic and through the midst of all of this.
Well, hey guys, so there you have it. 10 scriptures from 10 of your peers. And I just love how they all go to different places in the Bible. It's kind of like we talked about a couple weeks ago. All scripture is God-breathed, and the Spirit speaks to each one of us and kind of reaches into our heart and grabs hold with different things in scripture. I thought I would share a verse myself tonight, and it is Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, and it says, "For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he has planned for us long ago." And I love that because even in the midst of everything that's going on, long ago, he has made a plan for each one of us. And it just reminds me that I don't have to be perfect, that I am a masterpiece created in his image. And you guys are a masterpiece, each created in God's image as well. So I just thought it would be cool to kind of hear from your peers and how scripture speaks to them. Maybe one of their verses stuck out to you. Grab your Bible and highlight it. Or maybe you want to spend time exploring what God's word can speak to you this week as you spend time studying his word. So that was our interview segment tonight, and let us get on with the rest of the show.
Peace, bring it all to peace. The storm surrounds me, let it break at your name. Still call the sea to still, the rage in me to still, every wave at your name. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble.
Well, hey everyone, welcome back to the show. As most of you know, when we set out to do this, we did so with a very limited amount of time in mind. However, never in our wildest imagination did we ever think it was going to go into episode 6 with many more episodes possibly on the horizon. And while this has been an absolute ton of fun and we've loved every single episode of it, you need to know that if we could have met tonight in person, we would have taken that every single time over this way. But again, it's been a lot of fun. Thanks for hanging out with us. But it's time to acknowledge what's been going on in our world because significant time has passed now. And because of that, significant moments and significant memories have been taken away from us. And it's true, and possibly I hope that many of us have created some new memories, some new traditions, some new moments that we'll be able to carry on into our lives once we're kind of getting back into what we'll call kind of the new normal when that all happens and shakes out. But I want to address tonight kind of the loss that's been happening. As a former student pastor, my heart really does break for you, the student. Entire sporting seasons are gone. Prom, gone. Camps, canceled. Fun spring activities have been put on hold. Financial hardships have placed unique strains on our households and things that we grew accustomed to or were used to are maybe being taken away a little bit right now. Relationships have been strained as we haven't been able to really connect with friends in the ways that we normally would, or because we're stuck in a household, our sibling relationships, our parent relationships are being strained. Regions have been canceled. Well, maybe that one's not terrible. Just kidding. Maybe it is. In this period of time, many of us are experiencing a form of grief, a deep sense of saddening distress caused by loss. Now, oftentimes we think of grief in the sense of losing someone to death, and this is absolutely true, and some of us are in grief right now for that exact reason. But grief can also be felt by the loss of time, the loss of moments, and the loss of memories. And so as we take this kind of current reality for what it is, and as we take it one day at a time, it is okay to do so in grief. But in the midst of our grief, there is hope and there's even peace at hand. I want to show you a moment, a memory that some people had with Jesus in the midst of grief that left them with this hope and peace. And if you have your Bibles, you can meet me over in John chapter 11. Now, for the sake of time, we're going to have to omit some significant sections of John chapter 11. And so I want you to go ahead and make a mental note to read this in its entirety, because there's just so much good stuff that we're going to have to unfortunately skip over tonight. But let me introduce you to some people here. In verse 1 of John chapter 11, it says, a man named Lazarus was sick. He lived in Bethany with his sisters, Mary and Martha. So we meet three siblings. We have two sisters, Mary and Martha, and then their brother Lazarus. And we learn something pretty quickly about Lazarus. He's sick. Verse 3 says that the two sisters sent a message to Jesus telling him, Lord, your dear friend is very sick. So we learn something else. Lazarus is not just a little sick, he's a lot of bit sick. And we don't know exactly what he had, but it was bad enough for his sisters to send a message to Jesus himself to alert him that their brother was sick. And verse 4 says, when he heard this, Jesus said, the sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. So Jesus acknowledges that Lazarus is sick, but he makes some proclamations here. He claims that this is not going to end in death. No, in fact, it's going to end with God being glorified through Lazarus's current condition, his current situation. That's pretty cool. Verse 5, though, we read something that's maybe a little interesting. Verse 5 says, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. And then he said to his disciples, let us go back to Judea. Okay, so Jesus, at the news that his friend is very sick, he decides to stay where he is for 2 more days. And we could ask the question, like, was Jesus just being like kind of insensitive here, or was his schedule super full and he just couldn't make it? This was the earliest he could get there. These are all the kinds of questions we would ask someone who didn't rush to the bedside of a loved one who was super sick. But this is not us we're talking about. This is God. We are impatient. We are not perfect, but God, he is patient and he is perfect. And so is his timing. And it certainly seems strange, but we know that the story, according to Jesus, is not going to end in death, and God is actually going to be glorified throughout all of this. And verse 11 says, after he had said this, he went on to tell them,
Our friend Lazarus had fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him up. His disciples replied, Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better. Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead, and for your sake, I'm glad I was not there so that you may believe, but let us go to him. So in these 2 days that Jesus waited, Lazarus died. And verse 17 says, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. So combined with Jesus waiting a couple days and then him and his disciples trekking on foot back to Judea, that must have took a couple more, because by the time they arrived in this village, Lazarus had already been wrapped up and placed inside of his tomb for 4 days. In verse 32, when Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and he was troubled. Now we learn something that's really amazing about God here. At the sight of Mary and those who were weeping, who were crying over the loss of their brother, over the loss of their friend, it said that God was deeply moved in spirit and he was troubled. So why would this be happening to God in the presence of grief? Well, God is in the midst of his creation and his creation is hurting. And because of that, God also hurts. You see, God, he's not this far off, distant, removed God, doesn't understand what we're going through. God is in the midst. He's present in our current circumstances, in our current situation. He is there. He's in the midst right now as we experience grief, as we're in the midst of loss, as these things are being taken away from us, and as we feel the feelings we feel, God is there in our midst, and he understands exactly what we are going through. Not convinced? Let's keep reading. Verse 34, Jesus asked the question, where have you laid him? They invited him to come and see the place where he was laid. And at the invitation to go and see Jesus's friend, it says in John 11, 35, it says, Jesus wept. That's the verse, Jesus wept. And the Jews said, see how much he loved him. Jesus, at the very invitation to go see the resting place of his friend, says he cried. He cried in sorrow and in sadness for this earthly loss of Lazarus, his friend, as well as the pain that Martha, Mary, and the others were feeling. Look, our current situation right now with everything that's going on, none of this has been easy. We are in the midst of grief. We are experiencing loss. And so where is this hope? Where is this peace that I said was going to be at hand during this time? You see, the God who spoke the heavens and the earth into existence, this is the exact same God that we see in Jesus who joins us in our grief. And by doing so, he makes this statement that we are not alone. There's the hope. There's the peace. God of the universe is in our midst. He's present and he understands what's going on. He is with us. But Jesus made this statement earlier. I can't forget it. He says that this was not going to end in death and that he would be glorified through all of this. So far we've seen death and we haven't seen God glorified yet. So let's see how this all plays out. Verse 38, Jesus once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he's been in there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and the cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. Try to imagine this scene for a moment. Lazarus was declared dead, and he was doing what dead things do for 4 days. And Jesus prays aloud to the Father, not so that the Father would hear him. He knew that the Father would have heard him if he had prayed silently, but so that those around him would hear him pray. He says that what I'm about to do, I pray that all those watching would believe that you sent me, that I am yours, that I am you. And then he commands Lazarus to come out. And we see that still dressed in his burial attire, Lazarus emerges from the tomb. And Jesus says, take these grave clothes off from him and let him go. And I love verse 45. So far, the story all of a sudden has an amazing reversal. It does not end in death. God creates a new thing out of an old thing, and we have life restored again. But then it says this in verse 45, therefore many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did believed in him. God was glorified. The story doesn't end in death. And God was glorified. And what I love about this story is that in the midst of all of these things, God was there in the midst of grief. He was there beside his people, but he created something good out of those situations, and people were drawn closer to him in these moments. I think of the COVID-19 pandemic, maybe not exactly like the story we just read, but there is grief being felt. There is loss at hand. And we can choose to realize that God is present and in our midst, or we can choose to believe a false narrative that he is distant, far off, and doesn't care. That's not true. God is in our midst. God absolutely does care. And I love the invitation that he gives us in Matthew 11. He says, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. If that is you tonight, if you are feeling like you need rest because you are in the midst of grief, come to the one who knows and understands exactly what you are going through, the one who cares, the one who weeps alongside of us, but the one who has the power to speak life into people. Come to this God, and he will give you rest. Let's pray. God, in the midst of this COVID-19 pandemic, there is a lot of people who are experiencing grief right now, who have had these moments taken away, who are even in the midst of grasping with the loss of life. But Lord, there is comfort in knowing that you know exactly what we are going through, that you are the God who is in the midst of our grief. You are the God who enters into it willingly because you care. And you are a God who is powerful enough to do some pretty wonderful things throughout it. We may not fully understand it. We may not see it right now. But our prayer is that you would continue to breathe life into this situation and that, Lord, you would be glorified throughout all of it. Help us to come to you when our souls are weary and heavy laden. And God, we ask that, God, you would give us rest for our souls. That's your promise. And so for all those listening who have never experienced rest for their souls, I pray that they would be bold enough to commit to you, to receive you as their Lord and Savior tonight, and that lives would be changed because of the powerful workings, even during the COVID-19 pandemic, that you would be glorified just as you were glorified at the resurrection of Lazarus on that day. We pray this all in your name. Amen.
All right. Off the roof, off the blue car, off the silver car, nothing but net.
Over the house, off the chimney, off the front porch, and into the basket.
Should have called no dunking.
Well, hey, Brian. Hey, thank you so much for that teaching tonight. I just feel so encouraged that as we come out of this time of sort of social distancing, that we're just reminded that God is in the details and that he's not going to leave us and that he's going to restore. Things may look a little bit differently, but he's going to restore us to a place maybe even better than where we were before social distancing. So I'm excited about that. And I just wanted to say thank you for that teaching. But it's that time of the Tonight Show where we are going to send everybody on their way.
I know. And it really was, it was a different show as far as like order, but there were so many great pieces. And just thank you for your moment where we got to just see scriptures that are meaningful to people and why they matter. And then also for our worship team who are able to come together and do that song. That was just awesome. And overall, just a great show. I know that connect groups are going to happen after this and kids will be continue to be engaged. You need to know that As soon as we can safely meet back together, we want to be able to do so. However, we are committed to doing this for as long as it takes. And so, as always, continue to send us content like memories, commercials, Ask Scott questions, and any other feedback you have to make this show the best that it can be. And just thank you for your overall support and for joining us tonight. It's been awesome.
Absolutely awesome. I look forward to seeing you guys again next week, and you too as well, Brian.
Thank you. One more thing. Can I have my football back?
Yeah, here. You ready?
Yep. Oh, Wendy. Wow. That was a good toss. All right.
You're welcome. Maybe, thought you were going to let me keep it, but...
Maybe you should have been drafted by the Buffalo Bills instead of Jake
Maybe
Fromm.
I should have.
What's he doing out there? Josh Allen's the guy. All right. We're all done.
All right, guys.
Take Bye, care. Guys. See you guys next week.